Automation Direct has a number of different stepper drives, so how do you know which one to choose? We'll cover that in this video, and then at the end do a couple live demos so you can actually see what some of these features are. The drives fall into two groups. The ones in blue are configured by setting dip switches and jumpers. The ones in red are configured via software over an RS-232 serial link. There's a big difference in cost, so before shelling out the dollars, let's make sure we understand what the difference is. The first big decision is what voltage do you need to operate at? If it's 12 volts DC, then there's only one drive to choose. You're done. The big difference, though, is at the other end. If you need higher motor speeds or more torque, you get that by using a higher voltage. For example, here's a typical torque versus speed graph for a stepper motor. Sure enough, the higher voltage you use, the better the motor performs. Along with that, you need a drive that will support the amount of current that your motor is going to need. The good news is, this inexpensive drive can handle up to 7.5 amps per phase. There's only one other drive that does better than that. So the bottom line is, just from a voltage and current viewpoint, this inexpensive drive has such a wide range of current and voltage, it'll handle most of your needs just fine. By the way, did you notice that the drive part number is the voltage and current rating of the drive? This drive operates to 48 volts and 5 amps of phase current. Of course, if voltage and current are your only concerns, and you only need pulse and direction control, well then any of these drives are more than capable of doing the job. Just pick the one that meets your voltage and current needs, and you're done. But if you need other features or capabilities, then you'll want to take a close look at the rest of these categories to help refine your search. If we expand this category, we see that the least expensive drive only has two ways to control it, and a 12-volt drive only has one way to control it. The other drives have a bunch of ways that can be controlled. For example, instead of having one input be pulse in the other direction, you can have one input be clockwise motion and the other input be counterclockwise motion. And on some of the drives, you can even set that up so it's controlled in a jog fashion or via limits. You can also control some of these drives directly from a quadrature encoder. You can program the drive to run with no inputs other than an enable, or control the drive with an analog voltage input. And finally, you can control and query some of the drives via RS-232 ASCII commands. This one's real handy, especially if you want to monitor the status of the drive over that serial channel. They can all handle syncing and sourcing and differential inputs, and most have some kind of digital filtering. The next thing to look at is the steps per revolution. Again, the inexpensive drive handles a pretty wide range of values, while the advanced drives, since they're configured via software, can literally do any pulse rate between 200 and 512,000 pulses per revolution, and they can provide smoothing on any of those values. All of the drives have a way to enable or disable the motor, but only the advanced drives have an alarm reset and a speed select option when using that oscillator mode. Most of the drives have a fault output, but only the advanced drives can output motor activity or tachometer pulses so you can see exactly what the drive's doing. All of the drives have a self-test feature which tells the motor to rotate slowly a half turn in one direction and then in the other. This is great for system debug because it immediately tells you if the wiring is correct independent of how the drive is configured. Most of the drives have an LED that indicates any faults, the ability to tune the drive for load inertia, and damping and anti-resonance to improve the motor's performance. They all have some kind of idle current reduction, so when the motor is not being driven, you can save power. And the advanced drives even have the ability to control when the reduced idle current kicks in. Just don't forget that when idle current's reduced, the torque is also reduced. So if you need to maintain holding torque, you may want to be careful about how much idle current you select. Well, that should give you a pretty good idea of what the differences are between the various drives. Let's take a closer look at a few of those features. First, the step resolution. Automation Direct stepper motors are wired to provide 1.8 degrees of rotation for each full step. And if you do the math, you can see that there's 200 of those 1.8 degree steps to get a full rotation. Now that step size is so coarse that you can actually feel it when you hold the motor. And if I place the motor on a metal plate, you can actually hear the steps as the motor turns at 1 revolution per second. I'm using the 6575 drive right now, which has an option to smooth that, so I'll flip the switch, and you can hear the difference that the smoothing makes. Now that was for the full 1.8 degree step, where the drive is simply turning coils of wire in the motor on and off. The drive can precisely control the amount of current in each phase of the motor windings to provide intermediate steps. Here's what half steps, or 400 pulses per revolution, sounds like. A little better, right? Each jump to the next step isn't quite as large, is it? And here's that same setting with smoothing turned on. How about 20,000 steps per revolution? The steps are so small now we can barely hear them. By the way, in case you're wondering, I was adjusting the pulse rate out of the PLC for each of these so they would have the same rotation rate, which gives us a true apples-to-apples comparison. So the accuracy you need is determined by the step resolution, but it also determines how smoothly the machine runs. The LEDs on the drives that have them blink a code telling you exactly what's wrong. The green LED is blinking right now, which tells me the motor is enabled. Let's power down the drive, disconnect the motor, and then power the drive back up. On power up, the drive checks to make sure that the motor coils look okay. In this case, we see the red LED is blinking 6 times for each green LED blink, so something must be wrong. Now we just look at the handy chart on the cover of the drive, and we see that 1 green and 6 red LED blinks indicates an open motor winding. That's exactly what we expected, since we're the ones that removed the motor, right? So keep an eye on default LEDs. They're great for quickly diagnosing issues. Now please keep in mind that these devices generate heat, and if you'll be running them more than intermittently, you need to make sure they're mounted to a good heat sink and that there's plenty of air around them. If you need any help with Automation Direct stepper drives, please contact our free, award-winning support team during regular business hours. They'll be happy to help. And don't forget the forums. There are lots of folks there that love to share their years of experience. Just don't post any questions directed at Automation Direct support team there. They don't monitor the forums on a regular basis.